My castaway this week is an actor. He was born in London's Belgravia, the son of a soldier and an Italian contessa who was a noted Edwardian beauty. In a career spanning 50 years, he's acted in 27 plays, performed on radio, television and on record, and taken part in 230 films. Though the statistics display versatility, he is universally known for one particular type. The Curse of Frankenstein, Dracula, Theatre of Death, the titles tell all. Suave, cool and dripping with blood, he is British cinema's king of horror, Christopher Lee. And yet, strange to say, Christopher, you haven't made a horror film for, what, 23 years?
Something like that, yes, 22, 23 years.
But the reputation sticks. How much do you mind?
I mind if people only think of me as having done that and nothing else. I don't mind because there are over 200 other films which disprove the fact that I am committed and shackled to the playing of one particular role in one particular kind of film. I made my name known, and my face, which at first was unrecognizable, became known as a result of doing those pictures for Hammer from 1957 onwards. I have always been extremely grateful for the fact that I was given the chance and the opportunity to play a character which, by a stroke of good fortune, happened to hit home all over the world.
Thank you.
So it's been a blessing and a curse,
yes,
hasn't it? But I want to explore both of those aspects of it with you. But let's get on to your music, which is all opera, because as I understand it, you might, had you not gone into Hammer horror, or Hammer fantasy, as you prefer, you might have been an opera singer.
Yes. My great-grandparents founded the first opera company in Australia ever, round about the beginning of the 19th century. I can't remember exactly when. And they had five gorgeous daughters, my great aunts, three of whom I knew when I was a very small boy, and they were very elderly ladies, and two sons, one of whom was my grandfather. Now, she was an incredible woman, my great-grandmother, and she became world famous as the Tasmanian Nightingale. I have all the old programmes and silk and paper and so on.
So it's in the blood, is it?
It's in the blood. My mother had a good singing voice, never used it professionally, and I inherited it. Mm. It's an instrument I was given at birth. It's a gift. It's nothing to do with me. And I never really knew that I had this voice until one day in Sweden, in the summer, I was singing at a rather boozy party, which is not unknown in Sweden, particularly in the summer, and I got a sort of pull on the arm, and I turned round, and there was a small, stocky man whom I instantly recognised, who looked at me, and he said, you have a voice. You should use it. Come tomorrow at 11 to the Opera House. You know the Opera House in Stockholm? I said, yes, I do. And sing to me at 11 o'clock. Well, I didn't think he would be there, but he was. And I have a vague recollection of singing Don Giovanni's Serenade, which probably sounded like a call to arms. I was so nervous. And I sang in French, in English, in German, in Russian, and in Italian. So I must have sung at least five things. At the end of it, he said, I'll get in touch with you. He did. The upshot of it was that the Stockholm Opera said to me, we will take you, and we will train you, and you will eventually become a member of the company. But you've got to look after your own board and lodging. Well, I didn't have the money. So it's the greatest disappointment of my entire life because it's a gift wasted. I have sung in films. I have sung in sort of concert things with amateur groups and professional groups. And I've even sung with the man himself.
And the man in question is going to sing to you on your island.
He is indeed. And his name, Jussi Björling, the Caruso of the North.
Jussi Björling singing Offenbach's La Belle Hélène. Perhaps it isn't entirely chance that you got into horror, Christopher Lee, because you apparently bear an uncanny resemblance to the original 15th century figure who inspired the legend of Dracula.
Vlad Tepes, Vlad the Impaler. And he did exist. By some strange coincidence, except that my eyes do not bulge, I certainly do resemble him. It's a bit weird, really.
There are original pictures of him, or woodcuts?
There is a picture. Oh, yes, there's more than one. There's a picture which is in a castle in Austria, which is a famous one, where the eyes are very prominent. But there are also quite a few woodcuts and drawings of him.
But you've said before now that you've never played him correctly. That's to say, as Bram Stoker, his creator, saw him. How was that?
Well, if you read the book, you will see that when Jonathan Harker comes to the castle and the door is opened, I can't remember the precise words, but I can get pretty close. There in front of me or before me, or whatever, stood a very old man, very tall old man, with white hair and a white moustache, a long white moustache, dressed entirely in black from head to foot without a speck of colour. Now that's Stoker. It's not Hammer. I was in black, but afterwards they gave me a red line to the cape, which I thought spoiled it. So I'm physically wrong in those.
But you're also
films.
Supposed to get younger, aren't you?
That's right, but I did do a film, which unfortunately wasn't at all good. We won't go into the reasons for that. In which I did, and I'm the only actor, appear exactly as described by Stoker. And I got younger during the entire film. Younger and younger and younger.
And what's the reason for that? Is that the blood?
It's the blood, of course. The blood is the life, you know. And nobody's done it correctly. Even Coppola's film, which is a very impressive picture to look at, and he's a great distinguished filmmaker, even his picture, with all that money, labelled as Bram Stoker's Dracula, first time you see him, he's wearing a red, what looks like a red dress, and no moustache.
Would you like to have one last go at him, do him properly?
It would tempt me, I think, but it would have to be exactly the way Stoker wrote it, which is literally almost word for word, and I honestly don't know whether people would be prepared to come up with that kind of money these days.
Let's have record number two.
Right. This is not entirely personal. It's to do more with my mother. My mother was a very musical person, as I said earlier on, had a good voice. Never used it professionally. But because of the fact that she was born in 1889, she was lucky enough to be able to go to the opera and see all the singers of the Golden Age. And we come to the voice, well, the voice of all time, really, and the voice of Enrico Caruso, who knew my mother and always used to say when he met her, "Ah, la bella, la bellissima," which my mother wasn't exactly tired of hearing. She was very beautiful. But he was an enchanting man. And he's singing here with another man who also, in his particular way, was unique. And the interesting thing is the fact that the other man's voice, when they both sing together, it almost sounds the same, because Caruso's voice was a very baritone voice.
Enrico Caruso and Tita Ruffo, the tenor and the baritone, singing the duet Si pel ciel from the second act of Verdi's Otello, and that was recorded in 1914. Your mother, she was an Italian contessa, she was obviously quite a lady. What did she think of your going into films when you said, or into onto the stage when you said you would?
Her first concern, really, was the uncertainty of it all, although she did react exactly like an old-fashioned tragedienne would have reacted, somebody like Sarah Bernhardt. She literally reeled back and flung her hand up at her forehead. I'll never forget it. And she said, "You can't, you can't. And you think of the disgrace you will bring upon the family. Think of it, think of it. And think of the appalling people you will meet." And I have to say, she had something there.
I see.
But, oh yes, but in the second statement, but she was worried about the fact that I had no money and what was I going to live on and the enormous competition even then and insecurity and so on. So I understood her attitude.
You were obviously a bit of a performer. Apparently you were rather good at knife throwing at school.
Oh, yes. Well, I, for some extraordinary reason, was very good at throwing things, whether it was a cricket ball or whether it was a dart or whatever it was, and I always seemed to hit the target. And one day, by sheer chance, I picked up a knife. And I threw it at something, vroom, straight in the middle. And I thought, oh, this is fun, I'll take this up. So I went on doing it. I can still do it. I've done it in movies. And I don't know why they did it or how they dared do it, but various friends of my sister's, who should be nameless because they're still alive, allowed me to use them like the living target in the circus. I actually once put this unfortunate girl up against a door and outlined her with about 6 or 7 or 8 different knives. Our father was not pleased.
And you've always done your own stunts in films, I understand.
I used to, yes. I'm not doing that anymore,
obviously. You've got the scars to prove it.
Oh, I sure have. Well, that little finger, I mean, that was Errol Flynn, which is a, you know, memory of Errol Flynn after lunch.
Did you cut it off?
Very nearly cut it off, yes, in a sword fight. I have, in fact, done more sword fights, I think, than anyone in history in front of a camera.
Let's have the next piece of music.
Right, now, the next piece, again, there's a personal element here. One of the greatest singing actors that I've seen, a bass, was a Viennese called Ludwig Weber. And I was in Vienna, and I was talking one day to somebody about the fact that I was so sad about not becoming an opera singer, becoming a singer. They said, well, look, why don't you go and see Ludwig Weber? I said, you must be joking. I couldn't possibly go and see Ludwig Weber. He's one of the great, great stars of today. Wonderful actor. And they said, well, go on, we'll introduce you. So I went along to see him. He lived in the suburbs, in Grinzing, I think, Vienna. He's very sweet, very charming. Viennese. And, of course, although he's best known probably for his Wagner, he was the greatest Baron Ox in the Rosenkavalier, I should think, probably of all time. And he sang it in Viennese dialect, which it's actually written in. And he gave me a couple of lessons. And he taught me to sing in Viennese dialect part of the song that we're going to hear.
Ludwig Weber and Hilde Guden and the waltz song from Richard Strauss's Der Rosenkavalier. So you were too tall to be an actor and your mother didn't want you to be an actor, but nevertheless you became an actor.
That's right.
Tell me about your stage debut. Wasn't it Worthing Rep?
Yes, it was. One play a week for several weeks on end. Marvellous training, of course, but the problem with that sort of thing is that after a while you end up giving the same performance in every play, regardless of what you're playing.
But you apparently did a lot of overacting and upstaging from up the back.
I mean, really embarrassing to remember. The first play I ever did, the first time I was ever on a professional stage, if you like, was at Worthing Rep, and it was in The Constant Nymph. I was playing Roberto the Butler. I didn't have much to say or to do, but I made up for it. And at the end of the first act, I was sitting in the dressing room with the leading character actor who hadn't said a word. And the producer, Guy Verney, who's been dead for some years, came backstage, opened the door, walked into the dressing room and said, oh, Christopher, he said, I thought I'd just tell you, in case, you know, I don't want this to be too much of a surprise, but he said, I'm sending the rest of the cast home. You can finish the play on your own. And I said, gibbered at him. And I said, he said, well, look, let's face it, you're already playing all the parts. So you might just as well continue to do it. You see, I didn't know that you didn't act all the time. My point being that if somebody came in and said, it's raining outside, you know, I'm sorry, I'm so wet, I would practically put up an umbrella to go with the rain inside the house. If somebody said, oh, I'm exhausted, you know, I would wipe my brow. If somebody said, oh, this is a ghastly tragedy, do you know who died last week, I would, you know, wipe away a tear. I did. I reacted to every single thing everybody did. Well, I learned the hard way.
But you didn't have much to say in a lot of your early films, did you?
No.
Weren't you in Olivier's Hamlet?
Yes, but that was entirely unauthorised. I was working in a film at Denham on the next stage called One Night With You, in which I think I had one line or two. And one of my friends, who was literally an extra, I met him at lunch, and he said, "Oh, by the way," he said, "if you can get away from the set next door, nip onto the other thing, and we'll find a costume for you, and you'll stand on the stairs, and you'll be able to watch Olivier directing and playing the player's scene." So I did. And I did shout out when somebody, I think it was the King, played by Basil Sidney, shouted out, "Lights!" Because, of course, in the play, as you know, you see the poison being poured into the sleeping king's ear, and he immediately, stunned with shock and horror, shouts out, "Lights!" And everybody started shouting "lights," including me. And I then fled. And to this day, I don't suppose, until the day he died, that Lord Olivier ever found out that I'd made this unauthorised appearance. But I was...
But it's on your list of films.
It's on my list of films.
What about the Battle of the River Plate? That was all in Spanish for you.
That was all in Spanish, and my language facility, I suppose, stood me in good stead over the years, because I've made films in Germany in German, and I've made films in Russian in Russia, I've made films in Italian in Italy, in French in France.
So you got yourself noticed in those early years. You put
yes.
yourself about,
yes.
as it were.
Yes.
And then in 1957 you were spotted by Hammer. And you and Peter Cushing did The Curse of Frankenstein. That was, for both of you, your first film for Hammer, was it?
It was certainly mine. I'm not absolutely certain if it was his, but it was certainly the first one we did together.
Do you recall the first time you met Cushing on the set?
He said in one of his books that the first time he saw me in makeup, he never turned a hair. And right at the end of the day, I took my makeup off and went in saying goodbye to him before we both left the studio, and I walked into his dressing room and he practically passed out. It's a good story.
But you were covered in, it was sort of undertaker's wax.
Yes, yes, mortician's wax, undertaker's wax, and God knows what else. It was very uncomfortable. It took about 2 or 3 hours to put on.
Thank you. record number four?
Now, record number four, again, somebody I knew very well, a very good friend. I met him backstage after a performance of Elektra in Berlin, because I was such an admirer of his, having seen him sing here at Covent Garden in German and in English. And we became great friends. And he had this demonic voice, and it could not be in a more appropriate role, the tormented Flying Dutchman.
Hermann Uder singing part of the aria Die Frist ist from Wagner's The Flying Dutchman with the Bayreuth Festival Orchestra conducted by Josef Keilbert. Hammer had started by dramatising, turning into films, popular radio programmes, I think, like PC 49 and Dick Barton. And then it did Quatermass, I think, from the television.
That, I think, was where they really first came to people's notice, when they did Quatermass.
And you say you object to the word horror, you prefer fantasy, but...
Horror sounds nauseating, foul, revolting, chilling, I mean, really chilling. And I'm an entertainer, for heaven's sake, and it's imaginary. It's an imaginary character and an imaginary story.
Yeah. And, of course, they were very moral, those stories, because the cross always won, didn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
You returned to dust, as it were, as the cross held up.
Absolutely.
And it's also interesting, though, that they never received any critical acclaim, those films.
Oh, no, really.
I mean, the critics were very sniffy about them.
Very. They really tore into them. Disgusting, repugnant, repulsive, repellent.
Yeah.
Not the sort of thing that British films should be known for, etc., etc., etc. You've never come across so many pompous, hypocritical statements.
But they're quite mild, of course, in comparison with what
compared to
today.
What they do now, what they've been doing in the last 10 or 15 years. This is the reason I don't do these pictures anymore. Everything is out there in the open. Everything is shown. Nothing is left to the imagination. Like Hitchcock, for instance. Alfred Hitchcock was a genius at that sort of thing. What you don't see is much more frightening than
the open door.
Well, I've said that. An open door is the most frightening thing on the screen. And leave it open. Do nothing. No music, nothing. And all of a sudden, the audience will get into a terrible state. Is there someone behind it? Has someone just been through it? Has someone just gone out? Why? And so on and so forth. The two most frightening films that I've seen, the only two that ever made me jump in this area, one was where you saw nothing, and that was Rosemary's Baby, which was absolutely brilliant. Terrifying and horrifying film. And the second one, which really did make me jump, was The First Alien, where you did see something. But it was so unexpected, out of the stomach, the alien, that it really did shake me.
Thank you.
This next piece of singing is really quite phenomenal because we've all heard about coloratura sopranos, but you won't hear it very often from a bass. Now, again, there's a personal connection here. A good friend of mine, Samuel Ramey, an American from the Middle West, from Kansas, who is today, without a doubt, the most outstanding bass in all opera. There's nothing that man can't sing. Absolutely nothing.
Samuel Ramey singing an aria from the first act of Handel's Rinaldo with the Philharmonia Orchestra conducted by Donato Renzetti. So by 1976, you'd had enough of horror here and you upped and often went to Hollywood. It was a kind of self-exile, really. Did you do the trick? Did you get away from this typecasting?
Absolutely. I worked with directors like Steven Spielberg in comedy. I hosted Saturday Night Live with John Belushi, Dan Aykroyd, Bill Murray, Gilda Radner. It's the third highest rated show in the history of the show. That was television, live. And, of course, the audience. You're sitting there on the night, changing your clothes, taking your trousers off and putting another pair on in front of the audience, sitting as close as I am to you and saying, excuse me, but I've another scene to play. That did more for me than anything else probably in my entire career.
Not least because there was a man called Steve sitting in the audience.
There was a man called Steve sitting in the audience. Steven Spielberg was whom I had the great pleasure of working. And I went into a picture that he directed called 1941, which was panned at the time that it came out. It has some wonderful things in it, and it's now, of course, doing very well. It's become a cult movie.
And he had you in Gremlins too, as well, didn't
he? That was Joe Dante, who was the director. I would quite happily spend the rest of my life making films with Joe Dante. He's a joy to work with. And Stephen too, because unlike many directors, it isn't a confrontation, it's a collaboration, and they like and understand actors and actresses. It was because of this that I did so much comedy in America.
But in the end, you came home.
In the end, I came home because I had nothing left to prove.
record.
Without any doubt. Again, opera fans, buffs, whatever you like to call them, would agree with me that there was really only one tenor, and again a Scandinavian, only this time not Swedish, Danish. And he was known inevitably because he was 6'4", up and across, practically, and he was known, quite understandably, as the Great Dane. And he loved life, and he was such fun. And in this particular opera, he is dead at the end, and he has to lie dead on the stage while the soprano sings, and it's the end of the opera, for something like 10, 15, 20 minutes. And he used to get awfully bored with this, and he used to sing a great deal with Kirsten Flagstad. And on one particular occasion, she actually said that he had spoken to her while she was still singing out of the side of his mouth, and he had a very strong Danish accent and talked very much like that the whole time, you know, and a very deep voice because he started as a baritone. And he said, "Hi up, Kirsten, I want a beer." His sense of humour was legendary.
And his name?
Lauritz Melchior.
Siegfried's Death Song, sung by Lauritz Melchior from Wagner's Götterdämmerung with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Robert Hager. You've been Christopher Lee in more than 230 films, which averages out, I think, about five a year during the course of your career.
Yes, except that, of course, sometimes it's a day, sometimes two, sure. Sometimes it's a week. A
month, if you only say lights, it doesn't take very long.
Well, yes, that doesn't take too long, but that wasn't in the script.
But you're 72 years old, and you don't seem to be...
73, hopefully, in about 3 months' time.
But retirement for Christopher Lee is simply not something he contemplates, ever.
No, I would be bored out of my mind. I would also drive my wife completely mad by being underfoot, you might say. At this time of the year, I can't go out and play golf every weekend because it's too wet or too cold, and I've got past that particular stage, thank you. Well, I'll play in the snow or something like that. I could listen to music forever. I could read forever. And I could, if the weather was good, play golf forever. But that's not what you'd call a particularly productive life. And eventually, in, I suppose, a creative sense, one would become terribly frustrated at not doing something which really meant something instead of just enjoying yourself. And so retirement, well, how many actors have you ever heard of who've retired? Very, very few. I can't think of many. And I don't want to be one of them. Thank you.
more music.
A very close friend. Certainly, again, in his day, which was right up until quite recently, I would say the number one baritone, operatic baritone in the world. And this is one of the most wonderful tunes ever written in any opera. It's an opera which is frequently performed, the Tales of Hoffmann, of course. And this is a killer for a baritone, particularly the final part of the aria. And it's this marvellous piece of music.
And the name of the singer?
Cheryl Milnes.
That was Cheryl Milnes singing the aria Santi Diamant from Offenbach's Tales of Hoffmann with the new Philharmonia Orchestra conducted by Anton Guadagno. Do you find the image of life on a desert island enticing, Christopher? I mean, do you think you could live away from your native Belgravia? Can you rough it?
Oh, good heavens, yes. I've been roughing it since I was 16 when I had to leave school. And I had to leave because there wasn't any money. My stepfather went bankrupt. I had to get a job instead of continuing in my studies. And I went into my first job, which was a messenger boy, an office boy in the city at £1 a week.
So this suave image, this sort of sophisticated Londoner, this man of the world, this Englishness is a bit of a front, is it?
No, I think you are what you are. I mean, you're talking about suave and sophisticated and all this sort of thing, which can be taken, of course, as a very, very much the opposite of a compliment sometimes. I know you don't mean it that way, but people think I'm a bit aloof. People think that I'm, you know, slightly forbidding and so on. Part of that's my height and perhaps some of the parts I've played. But that's such is the power of the screen. I've always had to cope. As long as I can remember, I've always had to cope. And I was always able to do things on my own. I was perfectly content, which is probably one of the reasons why I didn't get married until I was nearly 40. So being on a desert island, of course, at the beginning, with the sand and the sea and the sun, would be absolutely wonderful. And to be able to sit down and read just what you want to read and to listen to this unbelievable, wonderful music and these marvellous voices, all my favourite voices, almost all of them personal friends, that I could do endlessly. I would probably, if I got bored, start designing a golf course, if the island was big enough, or it would be a short par 3 course. That would take a long time. But I think that assuming that I no longer had a family, that is the most important point of all, assuming that I did no longer have a family, I could cope.
Last record.
The last record, well, here another legendary voice. He made himself most famous singing the greatest seducer in all opera, Don Giovanni, and his name, Ezio Pinza.
Vieni alla finestra, o mio tesoro, vieni a consolar pianto mio.
negio me di dar qualche ristoro davanti agli occhi tuoi morir voglio. Tu c'hai la bocca dolce più del miele, tu che il zucchero porti in mezzo al cuore. Non esser gioia mia con me crudele, lasciati almeno vedere mio bell'amore.
Ezio Pinza singing the aria De Vieni alla Finestra from Mozart's Don Giovanni. If you could only take one of those records, Christopher.
I think probably Sam singing from Rinaldo.
Sam Raimi singing Handel's Rinaldo.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Because I know him. So it would be like having a friend with me, in a sense.
What about your book?
I would be torn between The Sword in the Stone and The Lord of the Rings, because, you see, I'm going to cheat a bit there, because The Lord of the Rings is three separate books, but it is published in one book.
It is. You can get away with that.
And here is a man who created the land of faery. There is humour. It's tremendously exciting. And I read it every year. Every year. And of course, I see myself playing Gandalf. That's it. It goes without saying.
I think you've talked yourself into this.
No, because I also see myself playing Merlin. And there is more fun and more love and more beauty and more magic in The Sword in the Stone than there is in Tolkien's imaginary land. So I think if you pin me down to one book, The Sword in the Stone.
And what about your luxury?
My golf clubs.
To play on this golf course, which you will
to play create. On this golf course. It would certainly improve my bunker play.
Christopher Lee, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Not at all. It's been a great pleasure.
Thank you.